meeting.
Okay, let's do that. You do that each week, but today, just like other times we've done some things here, has been set aside special to bring Him glory and to renew our hearts and mind, not just through the observance of communion, but experiencing God before them. So let's go with God in prayer. Father God, we love you. This is your hour. This is your time. We are blessed, Father, by just being in your presence. We pray that the power of your Spirit speaks to each one of us this morning. And we respond to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Let's stand and let's worship.
Thank you.
On the first day of the festival of unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb is sacrificed, Jesus' disciples asked him, "Where do you want us to go to prepare the Passover meal for you?" So Jesus sent two of them into Jerusalem with these instructions.
"As you go into the city, a man carrying a pitcher of water will meet you. Follow him. At the house he enters, say to the owner, 'The teacher asks, where is the guest room where I can eat the Passover meal with my disciples?' He will take you upstairs to a large room that is already set up. That is where you should prepare our meal."
So the two disciples went into the city and found everything just as Jesus had said, and they prepared the Passover meal there. In the evening, Jesus arrived with the 12. As they were at the table eating, Jesus said,
"I tell you the truth, one of you eating with me here will betray me."
Greatly distressed, each one asked in turn, "Is it I?"
Rising, eyes are turning to you. ordained left, being electrified than the other people. I remember when I first saw the Master. I was walking along the road near the River Jordan where John was baptized. I was curious as to what was going on, so I took a closer look. Then is when I saw Jesus asking John to baptize him. John refused, but Jesus insisted. After John baptized Jesus, the Holy Spirit descended upon him in the form of a dove. And we heard a voice from heaven saying, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." At the end of his first year of public ministry, Jesus asked me to be one of the 12 apostles. From that moment, I have walked with him, talked with him, stayed with him, and prayed with him, trying to learn as much about him and his heavenly Father as possible. Now, one of us is to betray him. Surely it is maddening to think that this could be. Surely the betrayer is out of his mind. But I keep asking myself, is it I? Is it I?
Like Zacchaeus, I'm a tax collector. Some call me Levi, but others call me Matthew. My character changed from my relationship with Jesus. He changed my name as well. One day I was sitting in my office, said, "Come and follow me," and so I did. Later, I remember, we gave him a big feast in my home. We invited his disciples and some of my businessmen. But the Pharisees, they were complaining. They were complaining about Jesus eating with sinners. But Jesus said, "Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick." But since that day, I repented of my sins, and I called Jesus. I've studied our scriptures closely. I'm now convinced that Jesus has fulfilled every prophecy of the coming Messiah. But yet, he just told us a terrible news. News that one of us here at this table will betray. Do these men think it's me? Because I once was a hated tax collector? Do I suspect myself? Is it I? Is it I?
My name is Nathaniel, and sometimes it's called Bartholomew. Like many of the others, I am. Now, he tells
wanted to shirk the danger. They did not want to go into Bethany.
I rebuke them all by saying, we must go with him, even if we must die with him. I recall the Lord calming the winds on stormy Galilee, healing the sick, opening the eyes of the blind, unstopping the ears of the deaf, cleansing the lepers, and preaching the gospel to the poor. But alas, opposition had continued to grow to our master. His enemies were determined to destroy him. He would make us God's servants, while they would make God their servants. And in the midst of all this, it seems that one of the chosen 12, one of us, will betray him. Is he speaking of me? Is he referring to me? Is it I?
Is it I? After Jesus called Peter and Andrew, he came to me, John, and my brother James. We were nearby in our boat with our father Zebedee mending our nets. When he called us, we left our boat and our father and followed him. Since that time, I've tried to understand Jesus by loving him. Sometimes I think that he's as much of a God in human form as there ever will be. But I love him as a person, and he has returned that love. Sometimes he refers to me as beloved disciple. I've been with him through many of his trials and his victories. I was there on the Mount of Transfiguration, and we beheld his glory. It was to me that he revealed in his conversation with Nicodemus, where he said those wonderful words, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but will have eternal life." One day I would like to write down some of his sayings and his wonderful deeds, so others may read and know that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and they too can be saved in his name. Peter and I completed the arrangements here in the upper room for a celebration of the Passover. Yet Jesus has said one of us is a betrayer. It cannot be so. But it must be, or else he would not have said it. And I can't help but ask, is it I? Lord, is it I?
Your name is a strong tower.
Tonight, when he said that one of us would betray him,
I promise to follow him even unto death. But he warned me that before the rooster crowed twice, I would deny him three times. Even though the others call me the big fisherman, in his presence, I feel small and unworthy. Will I deny him tonight before the rooster crows? And if I do, what will he do? Will he disown me? Will he deny me? Will he close the doors of the kingdom to me? Was it me he was referring to when he said, one of you will betray me? Yet, I keep wondering and saying to myself, Lord, is it I? Is it I?
I am Judas. Judas Iscariot, the only Judean in the group. The others must have confidence in me. They elected me their treasurer. And surely Jesus has confidence in me. He selected me to be one of the 12. Some say that Jesus' words about love, money, greed was personally directed towards me. Of course I complained when Mary washed Jesus' feet with that expensive perfume. I still think it was a waste of money. And if the chief priest and I conspire, and if I have 30 pieces of silver on my person, well, that's my affair. What would you do if you were me? What would you do if Jesus wanted to be the Messiah and wasn't making a move? Now, Jesus hinted earlier that he knew what I had done. He said it earlier as he was washing our feet. What should I do? Should I sit back? Someone has to prompt him. Someone has to get him to make a move. Or would you rather be sit around like the others and piously, self-righteously ask, is it I? Is it I?
Brother, I've been very eager to eat this Passover meal with you before my suffering began. But I tell you this, I will not eat of it again until its meaning is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. Truly I tell you, one of you here will betray me. You see, the Son of Man must die, as the Scripture declared long ago. But how horrible it will be for that one who betrays him. It would be far better for him had he never been born.
Rabbi, is I?
Judas, you have said this, so go. And what you must do, do it quickly.
Judas! Stop me! Judas!
Thank you.
my blood. It confirms the covenant between God and his people, poured out for the forgiveness of the sins of many. I am with you now as one who serves, and you have been with me in my time of trial. And just as my Father has granted me a hand, I now grant you that right to come and sit in my table, in my kingdom.
I serve.
Jesus tells us that this is his body. The body that was willingly given over, beaten, torn, cut, spit on, and forced to carry a cross that he did not deserve to Mount Calvary. He did it for you, and he did it for me, completely innocent of every charge. He could have called down angels at any moment and stopped it, but because of his love for us, he did not. He tells us to eat this in remembrance of that body. Eat all of it. Sin, past, present, no matter how insignificant, no matter how horrible. It paid the price for all of it. And he tells us that when we drink this, to remember what that blood did, to look deep in our hearts and realize that it was for the insignificant sin in our lives and the great sin in our lives that maybe we don't want to give up or think is not that big of a deal. That blood paid that price. He tells us to drink all of them. As Brother Leon comes and leads us in a hymn, we want to think about that moment. That's something that's in each one of our minds that we think maybe isn't that big of a deal. Or maybe it's too much and we're ashamed to talk about it or to give it over. That blood paid the price for it. Nobody has guaranteed any of us that we'll walk out that door and go home. So ask yourselves, should the worst happen, should you not make it home? Is that sin covered by this blood that we've just partaken of?
Amen. Let's stand and let's worship. If you need to come and pray and ask our pastor to come out here, maybe you need to share that with him or others, and I won't have Christ in my life right now. Whatever your need is, let's come and pray. Let's respond to the Holy Spirit's lead. Be sure you know where your place with God is.
There is love that came for us, humble to a sinner's cross. He brought back shame and sinfulness. He rose again victorious.
one more thing when we leave today. A lot of people are involved in sharing and bringing this more to life. And I just love the question he asked. How often is it I, Lord? Am I the one that's maybe causing somebody else to stumble because they don't see Christ in me? Or is that sure? All those things are very good. But Pam Godfrey heard you. Pam, would you stand? Pam Godfrey? She went out that way. All right. Pam Godfrey, who's one of our newer members, took part as part of her ministry to do that. And as a result of this, we'll begin in a drama ministry where we can use some of this on Sunday mornings as well. So appreciate her, Vern and Carrie Baby, some of those that helped out with this. So just give a praise for all those people. Do the public speaking? Go, no. So God really blessed me. We're told, Pam, there she is. Pam, we just want to say thank you, sweetheart. Come ask our disciples. Now let's go back here so we can kind of talk to them and welcome, just make it to know you a little bit. And we'll be dismissed. So let's stand. And I want to let you know that the worship choir ministry and band is working this afternoon at 5:30 for an exciting Easter service next Sunday. No activities this Wednesday night because everybody's on spring break. And the kids are. I don't know where the adults are, but the kids are on spring break. So we won't have anything this Wednesday night at 5:30 today. We'll be required more. Thank you so much. Lord God, we thank you for your awesome presence. We thank you for every person that's had a part of it. But most of all, we thank you for your love, your grace, and for forgiveness of sin. Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless. Have a great week. Hope to see you Easter Sunday.